Today I want to talk about WebTransport and WebCodecs. These are two separate APIs that are both useful in their own right, but when combined, they're really useful for cloud gaming. So the problem, or problems, that led to these two APIs include that we found WebRTC was not a great fit for cloud gaming. You can certainly do it, and I'll explain how, but there are a lot of inflexibilities or problems. Similarly, MSE, you can do cloud gaming with MSE, but it's not a great fit. There are problems. And we also found that WebSockets are not a great fit for gaming in general because of the head-of-line blocking. And a lot of game developers have asked for something closer to UDP, but the WebRTC data channel, which could be that, is difficult to use in a client-server context, so it's also not a great fit for that. So from all these different directions, we've kind of keep landing on the same set of solutions, which are these two APIs that go well together. You can kind of think of it like this. We have two very high-level APIs, one of them being WebRTC and the other being media source extensions, which is usually used with HTTP, although it could be used with the WebRTC data channel or WebSockets. And they're both good for their use cases. But if you want to do a use case that doesn't quite match, you're kind of stuck in between. And that's where cloud gaming falls. It's like this in this valley between two high-level APIs. And it's like that meme where the person looks over here and goes, ugh, and over there, ugh. And they need something we could do a high-level API that's specific to cloud gaming, but I think that would be a mistake. I think it's better to provide low-level APIs that could fit the use case, but other use cases as well. Ta-da, WebTransport and WebCodecs. Those are the low-level APIs that I want to explain. So a couple examples of things posted online. Somebody posted this Hacker News article about WebRTC, the future of games, but they said it's still hard to use in a server client architecture, and that is really true. Some people figure it out just fine and tell me it's not so bad, but a lot of people say it is bad. Similarly, people post articles like this and say, wow, if a UDP equivalent of WebSockets was around, it would be great for games. And I'll get to why we can't quite do that, but WebTransport is basically the best thing that you'll get. Similarly, there's a lot of work going on to make MSE better for live streaming and low latency things. And I think that the logical conclusion to this, adding more and more capabilities and knobs, making it more and more low level, or have more and more low level capabilities, would it eventually be the decoder side of WebCodecs, although WebCodecs includes encoder side as well. So what is the logical conclusion? The logical conclusion would be to close that app gap between mobile apps and web apps. So mobile apps have APIs like this, where you have a UDP datagram socket at the bottom and a media codecs API at the bottom to let you do the lowest level thing that you could imagine for codecs and for transport on the network. And this is the kind of stuff the games like. So why don't we just give you web versions of that? And for web codecs, basically we can. There's nothing inherent about codecs that prevents us from being able to do that. For transport, it is a little more tricky because UDP isn't secure. So we need to add in some way encryption, congestion control, and cores or consent, depending on how you look at it. So what if there's a way that we could get those three things? The answer is QUIC, or HTTP3. So if you're not familiar with HTTP3 and QUIC, you should look into it because it's great stuff. QUIC allows for fast connection setup. It's secure. It has congestion control that's pluggable, so you can get low latency congestion control. It allows you many reliable streams, unlike TCP. And it also gives you unreliable or unordered datagrams. It can be P2P with ICE, like the WebRTC data channel is. It's the basis for web HTTP3, which means that over time, it will probably just naturally fall into your stacks that you're using on your servers and your clients. And it's already widely deployed, so it's kind of proven in production. And many implementations of it are coming, especially as it gets further, or as the standardization process in the ITF completes. So it can benefit your games just by the nature of using it as it rolls into your server stack, or if you're going to be doing peer-to-peer stuff, because you can do faster game loading and it will also be more resilient over the network. That's the reason this whole work was being done. But if you're going to be doing more advanced things, in particular cloud gaming, you're going to want something more than just HTTP3. You're going to want to go a little lower, and that's what web transport is all about. So to explain that, I want to explain the different ways people are doing cloud gaming today and how web transport and web codecs could be a better fit. So today there are roughly three ways. And one of them is to use WebRTC directly. And in this case, you would need to run the WebRTC protocol stack on your server, which is a combination of ISD, TLS, and SRTP. All of the receiver or client-side activity for depacketizing, buffering, decoding, and rendering of the things sent by the server is done by the browser. And there's very little that the application on the web client side can do with that data. And so it has certain downsides. It is hard to use in a client-server architecture, as pointed out. Everything's controlled by the browser. And it's also based on RTP, and RTP has certain limitations, like it doesn't really have support for generic data. So some people choose instead to use just the WebRTC data channel and sends the media over as generic data, not in RTP, but rather in SCTP, and then take that data and decode it using MSE. And this also works and has different pros and cons, but it still has various downsides. It's still hard to use on a client-server architecture because it shares many of the WebRTC protocols. And the behavior to make, the way to make MSE currently be low latency is kind of implicit magic, and it only works on some browsers. And you also have to containerize the media before you put it in, and then it immediately just decontainerizes it before putting it in a buffer. So those things are being worked on in one way or another to improve MSE, as I mentioned, but I think we can do better. Some people, rather than use MSE because of its limitations, just drop down to WASM and decode everything in WASM. In this sense, they get to control all the buffering, and they can even make a custom codec. But it does have the problems of quality and battery life, because you're not going to be able to get as good of decode as you would. I mean, maybe as WASM improves with SIMD, it'll get closer, but certainly never is never going to be as good as hardware decoders that the browser has access to. And it happens to be that the person that I know of that's using WASM for this is also using WebSockets, which I found kind of surprising. WebSockets has the problem that it's running a TCP, which means that it has head-of-line blocking, which is going to be problematic for latency. So we could do better. On the transport side, web transport is basically, you can think of, it's based on QUIC, and it's a combination of all the good things of RTC data channel and WebSocket, but it's better than both. It gives you reliable and ordered and also unreliable and unordered delivery. It's easy to use in a client-server architecture. You can do both client-server and PDP. It provides datagram support, but it's secure because it has all the same security properties of the two, meaning encryption, congestion control, and cores or consent. And it's faster than all of them. It has fewer RTCs to set up and has pluggable congestion control. Theoretically, SCTP has pluggable congestion control, but no one's actually ever done anything with that. And it has a better API. We've made it a more modern API, in particular, has support for back pressure. We can also do better on the codecs, which are basically to take the codecs that are below the existing web APIs. In particular, MSC and WebRTC have decoders below them. And then there's on the encode side, WebRTC and an API called Media Recorder. And we can just expose those directly to the web, although with a web-friendly, performance-friendly way. So the status of these things are that web transport, we have for Chromium and for Edge Preview an origin trial of the peer-to-peer version. And we are looking for customers to properly prioritize or justify the work on doing the client-server version. Similarly, on web codecs is a little less far along. There is a proposal and an explainer, and we're looking for interest from people to know how to prioritize or justify the work in implementing that. If you want more info, here are some links for the origin trial, the announcement and documentation and sample code. For the web transport, there's the proposal and the explainer and the spec. And for web codecs, there's a proposal and explainer and a repository for a future spec. We have not yet published a spec there. So as I mentioned, we're looking for customers. We really want to know what your use cases are, where this could be useful, and what you would like to see in these APIs, and what you care most about, client-server or peer-to-peer or cloud gaming or normal gaming or communication games. I think I missed a slide, actually. Oh, right. So this isn't just about cloud gaming. There are lots of other use cases where this, or benefits where this is useful. For one, as I mentioned before, people game developers have been asking for raw UDP sockets so they can send game state like to or from a server. And this would allow you to have something very close to UDP datagrams, except secure. And similarly, if you want to push game assets down in a streaming fashion from a server, this will allow you to do it with lower latency. If you want to do communication during a game, which many people use WebRTC for, you could do that with this, only you'd be using the same set of APIs rather than a completely different set of APIs, and you could have more control over the buffering. You could upload media to a server for doing machine learning processing. You'd be able to transcode game assets if you needed to. Several people have brought that up to us, but be able to do it in faster than real time. The current media recorder API only does things in real time, not faster than real time. You could potentially get new codecs faster than you currently do, because in order to implement a new codec, it requires a bunch of extra stuff. Like in WebRTC, all the RTP payload formats have to be defined. But if you just were given the codec directly, there's much less that needs to be implemented in the browser that you need to wait for. Similarly, if new container formats or there are certain container formats that aren't supported in the browser that you would like, you can just do that in a JavaScript library on top of this. And if you're going to be doing advanced things like temporal or spatial scalability or end-to-end encryption in your group communication, these APIs, when combined, allow for that, whereas current APIs either are limited in their support or don't allow it at all. So yeah, that's it. I'm looking to hear back who would find this useful and for what use cases and what things are important to you.